We have a weird little niche, an area of specialization that we fit into. Our goal is to preserve biodiversity, aquatic biodiversity, and in particular non-native fish in the southeastern United States. But we do it in weird ways. We specialize on captive propagation of fish, non-game fish, that nobody's ever worked with. You know that a lot of fish that we fish for, game fish, like trout and bass, are propagated in state and federal hatcheries. But they don't do non-game fish. When we started doing it, we were the only people who ever even tried. We also do a lot of other work that's associated with it, like habitat assessment and low impact monitoring, which we do by snorkeling. We put on wetsuits and dry suits, and we lay in the water. Usually it's wadeable water. You reach the bottom of your hands when you're snorkeling. And we count fish. And I don't know if you've ever heard of CPUE, it's catch per unit effort. That's the measure of how many fish are present that a lot of fishery biologists use. We use observations per unit effort, OPUE. You may not be aware of it, but the southeastern United States is like the rainforest in terms of aquatic biodiversity. If you look out west, out in the northwest of the United States, the Columbia River Basin, there's 33 species of fish. If you look south of that, in the Colorado, which is an even bigger river basin, there's not many more species there. But if you look here in the southeast, tiny little watersheds, like in this case, the Clinch, has over 100 species of fish in far smaller space than what's out there. The Duck River, more than that, almost 150 species. And right here, just over the Laurel Creek divide, if you go up the road here, is the start of the Little River. The Little River has almost 100, has over 100 species of fish in it. And we do a lot of work in the Little River, and we've done a lot of work in the park too. This is an indication of the status of a lot of species in different parts of this country. And if you look at, this area right here, that's the Tennessee River and the what's the river system north of Tennessee?
Cumberland.
The Cumberland. Tennessee Cumberland River systems have more species and more species that are in trouble, that are in peril, for a lot of different reasons, than anywhere else in the United States. This is what a stream should look like. This is Hazel Creek here in the park, on the south side of the park, turns into Fontana Reservoir. And you can't really see it very well, but if you were to look into the water right here, it's crystal clear, absolutely crystal clear. There's no silt or sediment on the bottom, it's just gravel and sand. It's clean. And that's because the entire watershed is forested. There's nothing disturbing the vegetation and allowing soil and sediment to wash into these streams. So these streams are pristine, they're perfect. Is what streams should look like. Unfortunately, as soon as you get outside the park, even in the Cherokee National Forest, like right here, see all that mud? That's coming down this little creek right here. This is Sitico Creek in the Cherokee National Forest. And that little creek is draining some logging that was done in the Forest Service lands. And that disturbance of the soil and recent rain is washing all that silt and sediment in Sitico Creek. There's other streams that have lots of cows in them. And then there's streams like in Knoxville, this is on Third Creek, there's all kinds of water quality problems. You don't want to swim in Third Creek. You get sick. And of course, our big rivers are mostly dams. That's one of the worst thing that's been done throughout the Southeast by TDA, Corps of Engineering, and others, is damming them. Not just because it creates a barrier by the concrete itself, but everything above the dam, the lake, the reservoir, is foreign to a river or stream going, flowing water growing fish. They can't survive in the reservoir. They also can't survive for miles downstream of the reservoir because most of them let water off the bottom of the reservoir where it's really, really cold. It's usually anoxic with no oxygen. So everything below the dam is dead for quite a while. It's a dead zone. Unless you're doing like TVA's now doing and oxygenating the water and in some cases warming it. Well, what CFI does, you can sum up its importance. in a nice quote by E.O. Wilson. If y'all ever heard of E.O. Wilson, he's a biologist up in the Northeast. He's done a lot of important work. And he says that what we're doing is destroying the environment with a lot of species and destroying those species is one thing that our children are never going to forgive us for. Because when they're gone, you can't bring them back. You can't bring them back. So what does CFI do? Well, we work to save and repel fish from extinction through those methods that I mentioned before, captive propagation and habitat assessment. A lot of our work is very typical work with nets, with seines, or with dip nets, or things like that, just like most fisheries biologists use. Same tool. And we do that too. This is up on the cliff. We also do a lot of this. Like I mentioned before, we spend a lot of time snorkeling. This is actually Dr. Eckhart's son, Michael. This is an ancient photo. This is 20, 30 years ago. And this is some of the girls, a couple of the girls at CFI. That's Crystal and Missy, snorkeling in Citico Creek. And what we do in Citico Creek and in Abrams Creek is every year, annually, we go back to the exact same places where we have transects laid out. And we snorkel them. Basically just snorkel up, observing the number of fish, and we know how wide an area we're doing our observations in. So we can actually measure the number of fish per square meter and compare it to previous year's findings. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but I want you to understand that it doesn't matter what we do in terms of propagating and reintroducing fish, if there's no good habitat there to support those fish, they're not going to live. They're going to die. So the first thing you've got to do is find places that have suitable habitat that's going to support this fish. And you can do habitat restoration in places where it's been messed up. You can clean up pollutants entering the water. You can actually physically redesign a stream with heavy equipment. You can do a lot of stuff. But if you don't have that habitat there, you're not going to be able to recover the fish. And then you can recover the fish a lot of different ways in a restored or intact stream. You can stock fish. I mean, you can actually go catch them from somewhere and translocate them. And that's what typically people have done in the past. They actually tried to do that with one fish, the spotfin chub, here in Abrams Creek back in the 80s. They actually translocated spotfin chubs from the Little Tennessee River into Abrams Creek, but they didn't take. Reef captains would propagate and stock a couple of other species that have to. I'll talk about that in a little bit. You can do a lot of other things with fish that you propagate. I mean, you can maintain fish in captivity, just like in a zoo. You can keep what we call an ark, a refuge population. And we do that with some species that we work with. I'll point one of them out right there. You can also find out a lot about how the fish reproduce, where they reproduce, what time of year they reproduce, how they spawn, how they take care of their young, if they do that at all. That sort of thing you can find out when you're trying to propagate fish in captivity. And you learn a lot about the life history of the fish. We also produce fish for toxicity studies by EPA and USGS-BRD. And we also provide fish. Do you all know that mussels actually have a larval stage that is parasitic on fish? So a mussel can't survive, can't reproduce without a fish host for its babies. And so, and you can go out and catch fish and use them as hosts, but they don't make very good hosts because they've developed immunity, just like we do. Fish are just like, you know, they're vertebrates just like we are. They develop immunity. But if you propagate a fish, they've never been exposed to mussel parasites, parasitic stage of mussels. And so they make great hosts for mussel life. Well, we've been doing this for a long time. We started here in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park in Abrams Creek. If you're all familiar with Abrams Creek, it drains out of the other side, the south and west side of the Smokies, opposite the Little River. But Abrams Creek's had a sad history. Back in 1957, they wanted to create a trophy trout fishery. This was about the time that they closed Chilhowee Dam on the Little Tennessee River and flooded the lower Abrams Creek. That isolated Abrams Creek from any fish ever being able to get back there from any flowing waters because it's a reservoir. Well, They actually dumped 55-gallon drums of rotenone, which is a piscicide, a fish killer, into Abrams Creek from Abrams Falls downstream. Killed out all the fish in the main stream. And the reason they did that is they wanted to create a trophy trout fishery for non-native stocked fish, rainbow trout. Anyway, they wiped out most of all the fish, everything in the main stem of the creek. Some things survived from the tributaries, fortunately. But that was about 90 species. That was the second most diverse stream in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park, right after the Blue River, which the Blue River we just saw has 101 species. Anyway, JR and I were graduate students at UTM and Dr. Etnar at that time. We'd been drawn basically by Etnar's reputation over the sonar to come study on it. And we worked with the park and with the Cherokee National Forest and TWRA and Fish and Wildlife Service. And ironically, most of those were involved in poisoning out Abrams Creek. And then they started giving us money to try to put fish back. They basically asked us, do you think you can propagate these fish? We were both in the right place at the right time. JR and I both kept fish. We were both aquarium hobbyists. And we propagated some other fish, some tropical fish, on our own. So we said, yeah, we'll try. And we started trying to propagate these guys. This is the first one, the Smoky Manton. This is probably the most important fish in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. It's called the name of Smoky Manton. It was described, given a description, and given a scientific name by an ichthyologist named Ralph Taylor in 1969, and he discovered the fish from poisoned specimens. They actually preserved some of the specimens that they killed in Abrams Creek, sent them off to the University of Michigan up in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and that was one of the places that Taylor studied. And he found this fish in a jar. He said, I've never seen this darn. I've never seen this manton before. What is it? Well, he described it, called it Smoky Manton, declared it extinct. Because he was describing it from specimens that were killed out of Abrams Creek. We'll get to that in a little bit. It wasn't actually extinct. This is the yellowfin manton, another species that was poisoned out of Abrams Creek. It was also declared extinct about the time that Taylor did his thesis in 1969. And then we also later discovered that this darter, the Simcoe darter, or formerly Dusky Tail darter, it was given a new name later after we started working on it. This guy was also found in Abrams Creek once upon a time. It was poisoned out and gone. And so was this popping chub. This is about a 4-inch minnow, not a big one, beautiful. Sometimes it's called the turquoise shiner for obvious reasons. Looks like turquoise. Anyway. These fish were all thought to be extinct when they're, you know, after poisoning in 1957, up through 1969, 1970. And then in 1980, some people were looking in Abrams Creek for spotfin chubs. They didn't find any spotfin chubs, but they found the Smoky Manton. This was Jerry Deacon, a good friend of ours at UT, also studying under Dr. Etnar. And this was the perfect opportunity to do a restoration, because Abrams Creek was poisoned out one time. It was still a protected place in the park. It was a forested watershed with good water quality. Great place to put the fish back. And it was just a perfect opportunity. And as like I said before, JR and I were standing under Dr. Etnar. We propagated fish before. They asked us if we could propagate some of these fish. Some of these fish, like the spotfin chub, actually were numerous enough over in the Little Tennessee River you could actually catch them and translocate them. You didn't have to propagate them. They tried doing that in the 80s, no success whatsoever. So we actually started propagating them, but that kept them ready. The mantons and the darter, you could not catch enough where they existed, where they were rediscovered in Citrical Creek. They weren't numerous enough to catch enough to actually translocate enough of them into Abrams Creek, have them take and survive and reproduce. So these are the first three species we started trying to propagate. It's a long story, a long learning story. JR and I learned a tremendous amount of We've never worked with million fish before. We never worked with any kind of fish like these guys. We actually figured out after a while that it was easier, instead of trying to get them to spawn and raise the eggs and the young in captivities, to go into Citico Creek when they were spawning in the spring and find the nests under slab rocks, collect the nests, bring them into the hatchery, rear them, and then bring them to stocking in April's Creek, which is what we do with those two species. We actually started propagating the first Citico bunch. We were successful with them for a while. And we also collected nests. So we collected nests of the two magpies and nests of the Citico bunch and stocked, after we raised the young, stocked them in April's Creek. And they took. And we used that experience to move on to Telco, which I'll come to in a little bit. Since that time, we've added a lot of partners. At that time, it was just the Park Service, Cherokee National Forest, Fish and Wildlife Service, and TWRA. Since then, we've added a lot of other states and a lot of other federal agencies, and a lot of nonprofit and for-profit corporations as well. They've all been funders of our work. Our work, I mean, we're a nonprofit, so people can donate to us, but very little of our money is from donations. It's almost all from grants and contracts from state and federal agencies. Well, since we started working with those first four species, we've added a lot. I just updated this the other day. I was very surprised. I had no idea. We've now done 76 species since we started doing this work in 1986. A lot of these are threatened and endangered species. If it's got a T or an E after the name up there, that means it's threatened or endangered. There are a lot of other species we've worked with, though, as surrogates, as models, as ways to learn how to do a species that is threatened or endangered. Sometimes we're not permitted to collect a threatened or endangered fish initially. So we have to use a surrogate. And then eventually we get to where we are allowed to use the actual threatened or endangered. See, there's a lot of darters up there. A lot, most of the fish that we've worked with are darters. The magtoms, the two magtoms were what we started with. We've done other magtoms since that time. But we've done a lot of darters. Do y'all know what a darter is? Good question. It's a perch. They're in the perch family. But darters don't have swim bladders. You know that most fish swim around the water column. If they don't swim, they don't sink. They stay where they're at in the water column. But darters don't have swim bladders, which have air in them. So if they're not swimming, they're on the bottom. That's why they're called darters. They dart around on the bottom because they can't swim up in the water column. And the first darter we first started working with, the Citico darter, has babies and very much like the adults. They're also negatively buoyant. They sink to the bottom. They're pretty easy to rear. The other darters I'm going to come to later, not. They have pelagic larvae. They're little tiny larvae are basically plankton. They swim around the water column like plankton and eat plankton. They're hard. They're very hard to rear. This is our hatchery in Knoxville. It's just a little 5,000 square foot facility. It used to be a heat and air place, a warehouse. This is an old picture, but that's what it looks like. And inside, it's full of aquariums. We don't do like a game fish hatchery and have raceways that have water from wells or water from the river or stream nearby. We actually use tap water, Knoxville tap water. And we use recirculating water and recirculating systems to rear the fish. And that's a little more complicated. It's not an easy thing to do. But the facility is just filled with aquariums. We've got these racks that are basically pallet racks like you see in Home Depot or Lowe's. And they work great because they're strong, they don't break like wood, they don't rock like wood. One problem is that they rust. So we've had to replace a lot of them because over the years they've gotten to the point where they've rusted too much. But a lot of tanks in there, a lot of water. Each one of these, one of these upright sections in between the uprights is usually one species, or one subspecies, or one population of a species that we have to keep separate. And they're all part of a recirculating system. I don't know if you can see right down here, but that's a sump, a big 100-gallon sump on the floor. all the water from all the tanks above it drained to it, and it has the filters that filter the water, and then there's a pump on the floor that returns the water to all the tanks overhead. And the reason that we do that is that it keeps all the same water within that one system, and we don't have to acclimate fish if we move them from one tank to another, because it's the same temperature, same pH, everything's the same. Most of our fish are not like tropical fish
that you can feed things like flake food.
Most of the fish that we work with are wild, non-game fish that usually eat aquatic insects. Well, there is no commercial source of aquatic insects, so you got to find other things to feed them. We have found quite a few live things that we can feed them, like black worms, which are like little tiny earthworms that live in water. It's great live food. These are brine shrimp. You can buy brine shrimp eggs and hatch them and feed them. And these are actually daphnia, or Syria daphnia, which we actually have a room full of containers that we culture all these live foods. Now, you can buy some frozen foods, like frozen brine shrimp and frozen blood worms and things like that. And we can train most of our fish to eat those frozen foods after a while. But they don't know how to do it at first. It takes a little while for them to learn to eat dead things that aren't moving. This is our room where we culture a lot of plankton. And we've got a lot of little containers. These are basically file boxes that you can buy at Target or Walmart. And we use a lot of these little containers like this because whenever you're trying to rear plankton, in this or daphnia or Syria daphnia in this case, they usually get contaminated at some point and crash, and you lose the whole culture. If you've got just one or two cultures, it takes a long time to get a culture going. So we keep lots and lots and lots of little tiny cultures with about a gallon each, and then we can just take water out of them and filter it through a sieve and catch the plankton that we want and feed it. These are eggs. Those are actually Sitico darter eggs. Now, I mentioned that we went out to the Sitico Creek and collected clutches of eggs and brought them back to the hatchery and reared them. Sitico darters will actually spawn these in the hatchery as well. But this is a nest that we brought back from Sitico Creek. That's a flat rock, right? It's a slab rock. It's usually laying on the bottom of the stream. Well, the darter is usually under it, taking shelter, laying the eggs under there, protecting them. So how do you think they get them on the underside of the rock? They gotta spawn them, they gotta lay the eggs. Normally you lay them on the ground, they drop. Well, they turn upside down, and they lay their eggs on the ceiling, and the male fertilizes them. Which is very nice for us, it's very convenient for us, because we can just go out and flip rocks and look for eggs underneath them, and just bring the whole rock back to the hatchery. And that's what we do. And then we're in it. Spotfin chubs would do something very similar. They like to spawn in cracks. They like to lay their eggs in crevices. They're called crevice spawning. We give them fake cracks, fake crevices. Normally it's a boulder sitting on the bedrock or a crack in the bedrock or something like that. These tiles are 6-inch floor tiles that you can buy at Home Depot or Lowe's. And if you stack them up, they'll lay their eggs and squirt them in the crack. And if you take the tiles apart, they're all the way to the center of the 6-inch. They're shooting those eggs 6 inches into that 2-millimeter crack. So it's pretty incredible what they do. But the nice thing about that is then the eggs are safe. They're protected. If they didn't do that, they'd eat them themselves. They're cannibals. They eat their own young. But this way, their eggs are protected until they hatch. And then they've got to get away from their parents because the parents will eat the young, too. Fish they're not very good protectors of sending the young after they're a little bit older. These are some spot fins out in the Telco River about a year after we released them. Normally, we keep them over the winter, release them in the spring. These are actually, this picture is taken in the warmth of summer, sometime in July or August when we were out there smoking. And you can take underwater pictures pretty inexpensively if you've got a little compact camera. And we've got quite a few that we carry with us all the time. Well, just like in Abrams Creek, we've been very successful in Telco River. In fact, in Telco River, we've got all four species, the same four species that were first attempted to be reintroduced to Abrams Creek. But we've also got spotfin chubs doing really well on the Kelp River, in addition to the two manatons and the sinker.
And that's where we sort them.
Way out there, I mean, that's about a foot or 2 feet deep back there. And we'll go along lifting rocks and counting fish and see how they do. I'm going to change gear here and talk about a few other fish. This is not a fish that's in the Smoky Mountains National Park. This is the fish that I first started working off for my master's thesis at UT starting in 1982, because I came to Knoxville during the World's Fair in 1982. This is the Barron's Topman, and it lays its eggs in filamentous algae in sunny places, sunny shallows and backwaters. Out of the Barron's Plateau. Y'all know where Bonnaroo is near Manchester? That's right in the middle, top down there. This is a beautiful fish. This is a male. Females are not pretty. Like a lot of fish and like a lot of birds, during breeding season, the males get gaudy and gorgeous. They're not like humans where the females dress up and the males don't. It's the opposite with fish and birds. The males get real pretty. And the males are very territorial and they fight with each other and they set up territories and attract females. With their color. Female top minnow is very plain, just olive, has none of this color. And that's the case with a lot of fish. A lot of the darters are gorgeous. I'll show you a few in a minute. But the females are plain, just for protection. Protect the eggs, the important stuff that they're carrying around inside them. This is another fish that we started working with. This is the fifth fish that we started working with. This is the boulder dart, which is federally endangered. It's only found in the Elk River way out in Middle Tennessee in the Fayetteville. It wasn't known from anywhere else. And it was about to go extinct there because of Tennessee's dam on the Elk River above Fayetteville. And we started propagating them and we learned how to do so. This was one of the first fish that we ever worked with that has tiny, tiny, tiny pelagic larvae. The larvae swim around like minnows. They're not much bigger than plankton. They're about 5 millimeters long. And they feed on tiny plankton, you know, less than a million. That's why you have to feed them, of course. And we've developed ways to do that. This is one of the first fish that we also started tagging. When we're releasing fish, if we see a fish again, we want to know, is it one that we released? Or is it a wild spawn fish? So we tag them. We basically tattoo them with what's called a visual implant elastic. It's a solid that's liquid when you have it in a needle, and you can use a little tuberculin or an insulin syringe, very small syringe, and you can inject it under the skin and leave that, and it solidifies into a hard plug, and it fluoresces. That's what this is. It is a fluorescent light that you can put when you're snorkeling, so you can shine the light on the fish and see if it's tagged or not. Here's a tag right there on a boulder dart, where we first started stalking them. We've stalked them in Shoal Creek, west of Fayetteville, west of the Elk River, and they've taken. They're established in Shoal Creek. We can't walk away from them yet. We're still stalking, but they're getting well established. And they've actually dispersed out of Tennessee downstream into Alabama, which is pretty cool. This is the biggest fish that we work with. This is a fish that's 3 feet long. It's several pounds. It's the sickle fin red one. Too big for us to go out and get eggs or nests or bring back the adults. So what we actually do, I think I got one on here. We actually partner with North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission on the Little Tennessee River, and they use their boat shoppers, which is basically a big shopper on the boat, and they can motor the boat around on the shoals where these guys are spawning, and they can shock them or stun them. It doesn't kill them, it just stuns them, and then catch them with a net, and then bring them to shore, and we'll measure them, we'll tag them. If they're running ripe, is what we call it, if they're releasing eggs or releasing milk, we'll strip them in the field, on the side of the river, keep the eggs and the milk, and bring them back to the hatchery, and then fertilize the eggs and raise them. And that's what's going on right here. This is an egg hatching jar, which is the same thing that's used, believe it or not, for game fish like trout. They're very interested in these and trying to get them reestablished, and they're kind of lucky when they trust the Cherokee, because they were very important to the Indians for food. They actually used to build weirs. You've maybe seen or heard of weirs, which are big rows of rocks in the rivers around here. And the Indians built these so that these migrating fish that were migrating to spawn were channeled into a small area, and they could actually be caught or speared and eaten or dry and saved. This is one of the prettiest fish in Tennessee. This is the blue bass garnet. Only found in the Collins River over south of Crossville in the Katy Fork system. And we're actually propagating these right now to try to restore them to the calf quarter. It used to be in the calf quarter up until the 1960s. And then something happened and they were eliminated from the calf quarter. So we're trying to restore them right now. Although we're running into some problems with what was probably happening to eliminate them initially, so we're not sure we're going to be able to establish right now. Well, they're a gorgeous fish. This little guy is 1 inch long. That's an adult. That's as big as they get. It's called the spring pygmy sunfish, for good reason. It's only found down near Huntsville, Alabama, in a spring, one spring, Beaver Dam Spring. Actually, it's very discovery in one other spring. The males get beautiful peru. They actually have to illuminate them just right. These were actually pictures taken with a flash so they pick up that, so they show off that color. The females, up top, they're just playing. I have to tell you before, they don't get there. These guys lay their eggs in aquatic vegetation, like the way right now, and it looks like a big snot line. I mean, it looks like amphibian eggs. It's just a mass of mucus with the eggs buried in it. And these guys are pretty easy to rear. We've been keeping an arc from, I think we collected 20 individuals 15 years ago. We haven't collected any since. So we've kept an arc population going the whole time. They're pretty easy. Unfortunately, they're in trouble again because there's Toyota Mazda is planning to build a gigantic plant above the spring and may threaten them again. So we hope that they're starting to speak up. This is another fish that we've worked with, a really beautiful fish called the Blackside Dace. There are other dace. We've got Tennessee dace here in the Little River system. And dace are like a lot of minnows. They get beautifully colored up in the spring, and then they congregate to lay their eggs. And if you've ever seen them all congregated together spawning, it looks like this boiling mass of color, even from above water. And if you're down there snorkeling with them, it's incredible. It's really sight to see. We've done a lot of work with these and propagated them in the past to do toxicity tests, which we've actually done in our facility, in our hatchery. Interestingly, they survived everything we exposed them to, even though we know they're sensitive to some things like mining and fracking wastewater, which is eliminated from the live stream. So it's not what it's better. This is a fish, another madtong, called Chucky madtong. It's only found over near Greenwood. It used to be found in Dunn Creek over near Cosby Park. There's not very more. These are some of the only fish ever collected. There's only been 14 ever collected. And this fish on the bottom was one of the individuals that was collected to describe the species back in the 90s. That fish up top, we actually collected two in 2004 on Winchester Creek. And we brought them back, and we were getting ready to spawn, and unfortunately, the female died. She didn't release her eggs. She was what we call egg bag, but she died. The male, we kept for another couple of years, and we could never catch another female. The 13th and 14th individuals ever collected were the last two individuals ever collected. This fish may be extinct. We've been back many times to TVA and TWRA and haven't notified it. So we're looking at something that's gone. This is a neat darter. It's called the blotch-side log perch. Log perch are fish that have tiger stripes on the sides. Broadside log perch actually have these little blotches along the side. Regular log perch, Persinica protes, just have the vertical stripes. They look like tigers. And they're big. They get about 6 inches long. That's really big for a dart. Most of them are 2 to 3 inches long. This is in the Little River, and we've been propagating the fish from the Little River and stocking them in places like Talico River. And I think the plan is to try to stock these guys in Abrams Creek, but they haven't approved us getting started doing it. They stop here in a couple of years. This is a banded garden, Ethiostomum vernale, again in the Little River. That beautiful green, looks like a blur. It's not a very good sharp picture. This is not one that we've worked with, we've never tried to propagate it. It's one that's common. It's one that nobody's ever going to pay us to propagate. You can actually catch it up at least to translocate if you wanted to introduce this. This is another really common species, probably the most common species in the Little River. Called the red line dart. This is a couple of males that are displaying to each other. And they're displaying, they stick their fins up real tall, just like you may have seen two cats that are fighting and they rear their hair up to get as big as possible. Fish do sort of the same thing. It's mainly to show off the colors in their fins. This should be Tennessee state fish. This is the tangerine dart. It's another big dart. It gets about 6 inches long. We've been propagating them. They're found in the Little River, all the way up to the sinks. They're common in the Little River. We've been reintroducing them into, have you ever heard of the Dead Pigeon River over near Canton in Newport? That was basically killed by paper mill in Canton. Well, it wiped these guys out. They're found in the Pigeon River above Canton, but as soon as you get down where the paper mill is affected with the river, it's killed them all out. So we've been propagating them and stalking them in the kitchen. It's too early to know if they're going to take them. This is what a lot of minnows do. Remember I told you with the base, they cover up and they spawn all together in a big mass. These are Tennessee shiners. They get beautiful red in the spring when they're spawning. The rest of the time they're silver. They're a silver minnow. This is the striped shiner, which looks totally different when it's not spawning. There's also some scarlet shiners up there. That's actually from Middleton. So. But if you ever get a chance to get out in April, May, or June and look for nests, oftentimes there are big mounds of pebbles. Big mounds of pebbles, and you can see them in the Little River right now. We saw them yesterday at the Y. And you're still going to try to know your kids. They build up those big mounds of pebbles with their mouth. They carry them one at a time with their mouth and drop them on this pile and build the pile up until it's bushel basket size. Pretty big. And then they lay their eggs in the rocks. And the eggs fall down in the rocks and they're protected from cannibalism or from anything eating. Safe from prevention. And when they're doing it, it's quite a sight. And this is my closing slide. This is actually a poster that was put together by Joel Sartori. Have y'all ever heard of Joel Sartori? He does a lot of photography in National Geographic. And he's got a project called the Photo Arc, where he's actually trying to photograph every species on Earth, not just fish, but everything that may go extinct, everything that's in trouble. He wants to photo document it for posterity, just like specimen in the museum. And he spent a lot of time at our hatchery because we've got more threatened and endangered fish species than anybody else anywhere. So he spent a lot of time photographing our fish. And this is supposed to be the other thing. I'll close here and you can ask me some questions, but I've got a video. And have you ever heard of Hidden Rivers? It's a movie that's been put together by a nonprofit video company out in Oregon about fish and people that work to save fish, including us, here in the southeastern United States. And I've got a little preview clip of Hidden Rivers that y'all can watch. Let's see if it works. The first voice you're going to hear is Dr. Eckhart.
We're all attracted to beauty, and there is an enormous amount of beauty in this water.
You know, I hear music when I listen to the streams out here, and I love just listening to the water.
That's my partner, JR.
There's some wonderful, wonderful things in our rivers. This is the hot spot. There's more species of freshwater fish, crayfish, salamander, mussels. There's more of it here than anywhere else in the temperate world.
Just a great diversity of species and sizes and behaviors and colors and shapes are all found within these waters.
Salamander. Big salamander.
A hot summer day and you put your head in that water and you're surrounded by life and turtles and fish and salamanders and all kind of creatures, big and small and colorful and all darting about. It was amazing. I mean, you're in the water with an incredible amount of life. I mean, it's water is life.
There's a lot of diversity here, and there's a lot to be proud of. And all of these animals are just kind of hidden from us because they occur in the water. Reds and blues and yellows and all of these colors I thought only occurred on coral reefs. And then you dip your head in the southeastern rivers and discover that you have these amazing colors here in your backyard.
And there's so much just right here and that we definitely got to know and learn and celebrate and protect.
Really,
take care of it. It's very disturbing to see rivers that once flowed clear and healthy and are now just trashed, you know, from our activities.
Right now, I am going to shift the bulk of the blame over what we're currently losing to coal mining industry and to siltation, massive siltation in general. Silt is still a problem.
The fact that a lot of these fish, particularly a lot of the rare fishes, require clean streams. They require rocks for spawning under or into. And if those are choked out with silt, they can't make a living. They can't reproduce, they can't feed, they disappear.
And we're altering the landscape to the point that it's unethical. It's not right.
A lot of people don't realize that they're connected by these threads that run downstream. Anything that winds up on the landscape eventually flows into a stream, flows into a bigger river, and it's easy to overlook that small actions that you do have an impact on the rivers in the southeast.
It's really important to keep in mind where things could go if we decide not to change how we value our land and our rivers.
You know, the streams aren't lost. That silt can flush away and the streams can recover. And if the stream isn't cleaned up, it allows us the opportunity to go back in and replace the fish that were lost from it.
And a few streams have cleaned up and things have improved, and we've started putting fish back into some of these streams. So, you know, by having the ability to do that, to be able to restore some of these things, you know, hopefully down the road that's going to be incentive to protect some of these places or to make them better.
We are in an era where I'm much more optimistic than I was.
I think there's an overall progress of knowledge and awareness of the value of our aquatic resources.
It is liquid life. Water, do you realize just how important water is to our planet and to man? And, you know, all this talk about the resource of water. Well, you begin to realize that many creatures on this earth, they live in what we drink. They live in what we drink.
Fortunately, there are getting to be quite a few people who do appreciate the value of the streams and rivers and the life that lives in them.
All it takes is a mask and your snorkel.
Everybody that comes in, I get the same reaction. Just had no idea what was in there. It's amazing. And I want to come back. I'm going to go buy my own mask and snorkel.
All we have to do is just get them in the water, get them mask and snorkel on them. Spring does the rest for us.
We were doing that yesterday. We tried to limit kids at the Y.
You can't help but to become excited when you immerse your body into the water and put your head below the surface and see all these things that you never knew were down here. Just getting in the water in a healthy stream and experiencing it for what it is without knowing anything about it is the spectacular reason that drives me to the water whenever I can. Got fish nibbling on me.